Children, please. How's life? How's everybody? Happy? MashaAllah. And how did you find this system of Atfal?
Good.
Have you been participating since this morning? Yes. Actively?
Yes.
And did you find it beneficial in any way? You did? For instance, tell me how. Muhammad, you stand up and represent all of them. Loudly, please give me the points. The points in which you are fully satisfied. Right? That's all. No educational program? Right. It will continue tomorrow. MashaAllah. Now this is the question answer session, as you know full well. Already the whole Jamaat is familiar with this. So no need for chewing words. Straight away, let's get into the session, okay? There you are already, MashaAllah.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. Introduce yourself first, briefly.
My name is Numan from Bradford. My question is...
From?
Bradford.
Bradford, right.
And my question is that in the Eid Namaz, the first Rakat, we have 7 Takbeers. And why do we have 5 in the second one?
Right. In the Eid Namaz, in the first, you have in fact 8, not 7. Right? And in the second Rakat, altogether there is 6. One when you rise from prostration, and then 5 more. Correct? Okay. Now the point is that the first takbir is said without any known takbir-e-ikhama. When you say ordinary prayers, then before you the prayer begins, there is a takbir-e-ikhama. Which means Ashad Allahu Akbar, Ashad Allah, La ilaha illallah, Ashad Anna Muhammad Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, Qad Qamat As-Salah, Qad Qamat As-Salah, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah. I've read it fast, but people normally take their time in doing it. This prepares people for joining the namaz. But because there is no takbir in it, so the extra takbir works a sort of warning so nobody misses. Nowadays it is possible through loudspeaker system to inform everybody to get ready. But it is not working everywhere in the world even today. In many third world countries in Africa, etc., there could be large gatherings where there is no arrangement for a loudspeaker. So this Takbir Allahu Akbar, by the time people hear the prayer is starting, they start joining and they don't miss much of the prayer then. See? For the first takbir, for the first prayer, I'm sorry, for the first rakat, to have 2 extra prayers is very useful. No, I'm sorry. For the first rakat, to have 2 extra takbirs serves a very useful purpose. That is just a guess I have advanced. It is not mentioned anywhere why. But we know all the teachings of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam were rich in wisdom. So there has to be some wisdom. Of that no one can deny. But now that you have raised the question for the first time, thinking of it, you know, offhand, I have just suggested this could possibly be the reason why. But this is not a final answer. If you think of some more reasons, maybe you yourself discover some more. Okay? Assalamu alaikum. Haven't you made some arrangement for the boys to sit in line?
They're sitting like this.
already. So they have to come from there all the way back. Okay.
Assalamu alaikum huzur, mera naam Mudassar hai aur maine aapko puchna tha, rozo mein taraveeh kyun padte hain?
Rozo mein taraveeh kyun padte hain? Kya padhna chahiye? Novels? Why this question? What is taraveeh? Do you know what taraveeh is?
Yeah.
What is it? You pray to God in optional prayers, nafl. And because in Ramadan you are expected to do everything good which is required of you according to the Quranic teaching more intensely than ever before. So the number of nawafil is increased, the number of zikr-e-ilahi is increased, remembrance of God. Normally people who do not get up in the dead of the night to remember God, in Ramadan they have to anyway because they have to get up for eating if for nothing else. So they are trained in the art of remembering Allah far more during the month of Ramadan than before. This training works for their betterment in the following months as well. They don't shed all that they have learned the moment they enter Eid. They're expected to get practice, get used to these things, and carry some of the lessons they have learned into the daily life, into the future. So when you say Taraveeh, in fact, first of all, this has to be corrected, that Taraveeh is not the real form of Nawafil which is expected of Muslims. It is a makeshift arrangement for Nawafil. And let me explain this to you. What the Holy Quran tells us is to get up after sleeping a while before the dawn and much before the dawn and start saying your Nawafil, that is optional prayers. And this is tahajjud. In Ramadan, essentially, every Muslim is expected to say tahajjud. But it so happened that at the time of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the second caliph in Islam, it was reported that there are many workers, hard laborers, or farmers who sometimes had to work very hard during the day, who want to get up for tahajjud, but because being too tired, they can't wake up at the right time. So the issue for them was either to miss nafl altogether or to have an alternative arrangement made for their sake. So it was decided that those who cannot get up at tahajjud time, they know they would perhaps miss them, it is better to say nafl before going to sleep. So immediately after the Isha prayer, these nafls, which are normally to be said at the pre-dawn period of tahajjud, they are said after the Isha prayer, so the poor laborers could return and have a good night's rest. And then they would wake up in time just for eating their sehri and keeping the roza following it. Now you know what Taraveeh means. Taraveeh is a substitute for nafl of tahajjud. The main thing is nafl of tahajjud. So all boys who or girls, whoever they are, who can get up enough time before eating their sehri, the best thing for them is to say nawafil before starting eating. And that is the real thing. If some cannot, because of being too young and sleep being too heavy, they cannot afford to get up for tahajjud, then before going to sleep after the Isha prayer, if they join Taraveeh, it is a sort of makeshift arrangement for them. Got it? Jazakallah.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Talha.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
My name is Talha and I'm from Hounslow. And my question is, why did Allah make human beings and how did Adam and Eve get their name?
Why did Allah make human beings and how did Adam and Eve get their names?
All that I know is that in the scriptures of old and in the Holy Quran, these names are mentioned. So we know that they were named this. Who named them is an open question. Did their parents name them or were they named by God? I prefer the second option because the way they are described, it seems that Allah gave them the names Himself. And this is nothing new. It happens. In case of, for instance, Jesus Christ, His name, Isa ibn Maryam, was given to Him even before His birth, even before His conception, through dream to Hazrat Sayyida Maryam Siddiqa, His mother. Angels told her that you are going to be blessed with a special child from Allah, and this is the name which God has given him, Isa ibn Maryam, and that is the name which was given to her, to him later on. So from this we are definite that the names of some very dear people of Allah are given to them by Allah Himself. The most prominent example, however, is that of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The proof that his name was in fact given by God, although human agency was used, of course. It was some human being who gave him this name. It was his grandfather, in fact. But it was designed by Allah that this is the name which will be given to him. Long before his birth, long before the birth of his forefathers, because we read in the Quran that his name is written in the Old Testament, that a prophet, a great prophet, by the name of Muhammad, will be born, who will do this and do that. So how could his name be written in the Old Testament if it had been accidentally given to him after his birth? That means that this name was decreed right from the beginning. It was in the Allah's knowledge that this is the name he will have, he will possess. And when you read the meaning of the word Muhammad, then it becomes evidently clear that it has a deep significance. So as far as the name of Adam is concerned, that is very likely to be given by God Himself. As far as the name of Eve is concerned, I am not so sure, but that could also have been given by God Himself. The first part of your question was, your question had two aspects.
Yeah, the first part was, why did Allah make human beings?
Why did Allah make human beings? Why did you start with that question? Why didn't you ask, why did Allah make anything? Are the human being not the best of all the animal kingdom? Don't you think so? Are the human beings not better equipped, better talented than all the beasts of the jungle and the other animals, dogs and donkeys
They are.
And worms and things?
They are.
So why haven't you questioned about those minor, smaller things instead of human beings? If ever life was to be created, the creation of human being is the very best of all the life. You understand the point?
Yeah.
So the question doesn't arise why Allah made the human beings. The question should have been why Allah made anything. Correct?
Yes.
Okay. Allah is the creator. It is His attribute to create. Allah is the life giver. Mohi is another attribute of His. And Allah is Rab, provider. So all these are attributes. And the attributes can only be attributes if they are operative and they work. Can you ask a flower, why does he emit fragrance? Will that be a good question addressed to a flower? Why does he, or address yourself to a rose and say, why do you have such a beautiful red color? Why couldn't you do without it? If you like the fragrance of rose, can you ask a question, oh rose, why do you have such fragrance? Why do you have such petals, soft petals? Why do you have this shape? Because this is the making of the rose. All these things are the characteristic of rose. And if the rose ceases to possess those attributes, the rose goes out of existence. Any human being, anything in fact, has his own attributes. And everything lives by its attributes, is known by its attributes. If the attributes are withdrawn, nothing is left. Don't you know that? Have you eaten today?
Yes.
What did you eat?
I can't remember. I can't remember because I stuffed myself.
You can't remember what you ate at lunch, this afternoon?
Keema?
Yeah. Keema? Which keema? Mad beef? Mad cow's beef? No. It was mutton?
Aloo keema.
Or some keema, okay. And how did you know it was keema?
Because my brain told me.
If nobody had told you, you wouldn't know that it was keema you were eating or dust. When you eat something, you know what you're eating because of its properties. When you talk of dead things, you talk of properties. When you talk of live things, then you talk of attributes. See? So without attributes, nothing exists. You recognize everything by its attributes. So Allah has the attribute of creation. So He must manifest it. There is no question why. It's invalid. Anything who has a property, He must manifest it. Got it? Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
My name is Samir and I'm from Hanzalo Jamaat. My question is that I believe that Islam is a true religion, but if I told my Christian friends, they would say that their religion is the true religion. So how can I prove to them that Islam is a true religion?
Why do you believe in Islam to be a true religion?
Because it's my religion.
That is no answer at all.
Yeah, but
then you are founded on nothing.
I've read about it and it says that.
You see, if you believe in Islam because it was the religion of your parents and you are born with this religion, you have inherited this religion, then you do not stand on any foundation whatsoever. First start learning Islam. Right?
Uh-huh. Right.
When you learn Islam and when you are convinced that this is a good religion, only then you can talk of Islam to others, not before that. Do you want me to start teaching you the elementaries of Islam right from the beginning to the end, now, in this session?
No, I can do it later, not now, because you're going
to... Return home, ask your parents, tell them to start teaching you what they failed to teach you before this.
I have...
Okay?
All right.
Thank you. Have you returned from your holiday tours? Did you go with your father?
Yes.
How did you like it?
It was good.
You enjoyed?
Yeah.
Did you have good long walks?
Yeah.
How many miles a day?
Don't know.
Huh?
Don't know.
You don't know. A guess? Just a wild guess.
About 2 miles.
Huh?
2 miles.
2 miles. That's what you call a walk. And that too on a holiday. You should have done 8, 10, 20 miles. Then I would call it a holiday. Eh? You just enjoyed eating, sitting in the room cozily and gossiping in the family. Is that what you call a holiday?
No.
No? So what did you do? What else did you do? Drive?
You would do a lot of driving.
Huh? Most of the time driving. Oh, what a poor idea, man. You should have opened up your legs, you should have gone up the car, abandoned the car, and run about and played and things.
Yeah, we went on the beach every night.
Beach every day?
Yeah, walk.
Watching the dead meat all around you. Naked flesh everywhere. Okay, come on. Yes.
Hazur, my question is, do Muslims believe in the Big Bang Theory?
The Muslims?
Yeah.
Why do you ask the Muslims?
Like us.
It's not a question of religion at all. It's a question of a scientific attitude. The Big Bang Theory, as far as the scientific name, the term Big Bang is concerned, this is not a religious belief at all. This is a scientific observation. And the theory is based on that scientific study, investigation, and observation. Right? So why do you say, why do we Muslims believe in the Big Bang?
Do you believe that Allah made
it? It has to be examined scientifically. And if it is found to be true, only then the question would arise that as far as our knowledge goes, we understand that the Big Bang did take place and this theory holds water. It's worthy of belief. So does the Holy Quran mention it anywhere? Something like this? Which will reassure us that the Quran is the book authored by the same Creator who created the universe. This should have been a valid question. You understand? So this is a too complicated an issue to be discussed here in this class. But if you want a brief answer, my answer is that the Big Bang concept is very clearly, specifically defined in the Holy Quran. While it has not been mentioned in any religious book in anywhere in the world, the Holy Quran is the only divine book which does not only speak of this phenomenon of creation, but specifically mentions and in detail and makes some further claims as to this phenomenon being a repetitive phenomenon, not an accidental phenomenon occurring once, but it's a repetitive phenomenon. So that is the short answer I promised you, and no more should be discussed here, because I know once we enter into the details of this question, most of the children will not be able to understand what I'm talking about. Okay? Thank you.
My question is, why did the Holy Prophet have no sons who lived, even though he prayed?
Why did the Holy Prophet not have any sons who lived, even though he prayed?
Do you know that he prayed for sons?
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
How? How do you know that?
My dad told me.
What?
Tell me. That's not true.
Your dad is sitting next to me. He says that's not true. He absolves himself of this. Was it your mom? Are you clear? Are you sure who told you? Was your dad or was your mom?
Your dad.
So you better settle it among between yourselves. Right? You see, God, number one, remember that prayer is begged of God. Prayer is not dictated to God. If the prayer is dictated, then God is the servant and the one who makes the prayer is the master. It's the other way around. God is the master and whoever begs is the servant. And even in the ordinary English idiom you may hear, beggars are never choosers. Those who beg, they can't dictate terms. Even the prophets of Allah cannot with certainty say that all our prayers are heard and accepted. They are heard in a different way, but they are not accepted verbatim. The Holy Prophet prayed for the guidance of the whole of Arabia and the whole of mankind, didn't he? But all of Arabia didn't find the truth, didn't recognize the truth of Islam. Many died, unfortunately, without accepting Islam. So for the prayer to be good is all right. But for the prayer to be accepted verbatim, all of it, by God, is absolutely a false idea. It cannot work. God is the master, and the one who prays is the servant. He begs, right? So even if you are right and your father is wrong, even if he told you that Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to pray for his son, still it is up to Allah. He accepted it. If he accepted it, he should have accepted it for a good cause. If he didn't accept it, he must have refused the prayer for a good cause. And in case of Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, many conjectures can be made, many suggestions can be forwarded as to why this happened, what was the wisdom in withholding a son from him. Right? Already you know, Shias have created almost a new religion out of exceptional love for the daughter of Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So much so that all who belong to her and who have any relationship with her, they are considered to be the custodians of the entire truth. And the rest of the Sahabas and all the thousands, hundreds of thousands of Muslims of that time who did not accept Hazrat Ali as the first caliph, they are rejected outright as munafiqeen, as hypocrites. So what a havoc played with a good idea wrongly used. Love of the children of Hazrat Muhammad Rasul is a good idea. When it is misimplied, then it plays havoc with the peace of Islam itself. So imagine if a son was born and he lived after him. one can, one, you know, one shudders with the possibilities of what might have happened. People might have made a god out of him, and everything would be monopolized by him and those who followed him. Well, Hazrat Muhammad was not only a prophet for his own progeny, he was not only a prophet for Arabia alone, he was not only a prophet for the East, he was the prophet of the East and the West and the whole of the mankind. So that is why God did not put the world into such a trial as I have just spoken of. But that is just a suggestion. Allah knows best. Okay? And when you return home and have it sorted out with your father, let me know how the outcome of this debate, eh? Okay?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
My question is...
And your name is?
Waheed Ashraf Meini from Bradford.
Right.
My question is, why are we called Atfal and what does Atfal mean?
Why? What?
Why are we called Atfal and what Atfal. Does Atfal mean?
All right. Would you like rather prefer to be called Ansar or Khuddam?
Well,
you, that means, I understand, you, that means that you do not know the meaning of tifl. And you do not know what atfal means in relation to the word tifl. Tifl means a child. And atfal is the plural of tifl. Atfal. Right? Like Nasir is a singular and Ansar is the plural. Like Khadim is the singular and Khuddam is the plural. See? So an organization which comprises not only one Khadim but so many of them is called Khuddam. An organization which comprises not only one single tifl but so many of them is called Atfal. And Atfalul Ahmadiyya means children of Ahmadiyya Jamaat in Islam. Now you know the significance?
Yes.
Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum, sir.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
My name is Subha Amini and I am from Bradford.
Yes.
My question is, why don't we read Namaz when the sun is directly above our head?
Why don't we read the Namaz when the sun is
directly above our head, when the sun is directly above our head?
Right. Do you say Namaz all the time when the sun has begun to decline until it sets? Why do you insist on saying the prayer at that sharp moment when the sun is just on your head and is about to decline? It occupies that position for a minute or two. And what prayer will you be able to finish anyway? And why must you insist? This is just an idea. This question has no practical advantage anyway. But I'm glad you asked, because this is not all about the sun and the prayer relationship. There are three times instead, which are mentioned in Hadith, that there are three positions of sun when no prayer should be said. One, the rising sun, while it rises. It occupies about the same period, same minutes or a minute or two, as the sun at its zenith occupies. Again, the sunset is a forbidden time. These are three times which had special significance in the religions of sun worshippers. You understand?
Yes.
In pre-Islamic era, there were many religions like found in among the Egyptian pharaohs, where sun was considered to be a god. Also among the Romans, the sun was specifically worshipped as a god. Also we hear of sun being worshipped at the time of Hazrat Abraham alayhi salatu wasalam. So the specific periods when, or the times of sun's movement, when the sun worshippers stood up and worshipped him, that is sun, by him I mean, but they think was a god. They were rising, the rising of sun, the zenith, when the sun is right on your top, and the setting of the sun. So because Islam does away with all sorts of idolatry and worship of false gods, so Hazrat Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed us that the movement of sun is referred to for describing the prayer times, not because we respect this thing anyway. In itself, it has no significance. It's just a measure to find time and to measure time. So you worship according to the positions, not out of respect for this thing. Particularly desist from praying when sun begins to rise, because this is the time when sun worshippers used to pray to sun god. Do not pray when it is on the zenith, because this is the time when the old people who worship sun as god used to offer their prayers to sun. This is the significance of preventing us or forbidding us from saying our prayers at these three periods of sun's movement. Right? Or earth's movement in relation to sun, I mean. Next, please. Has Bradford monopolized all the questions? Or would there be others from other regions who will ask question too? No, I think there was one from Jilingam as well, huh? Right. Yes, you are from?
Assalamu
alaikum,
sir. Waalaikum salam. I am from Bradford. My name is Wasit.
Again, Bradford?
Yeah.
Lord, it's hard. Your name is?
Wasit.
Right.
And my question is that, what does Ahmadiyyat
mean? Come closer to the microphone, please.
What does Ahmadiyyat mean?
Ahmadiyyat, yes, it's a good question. Ahmadiyyat is not the name of the religion. Ahmadiyyat is the name of a denomination within Islam which indicates that those who have accepted the Imam Mahdi and the promised Messiah, they are called Ahmadis. So that their identification becomes easier and simple. There's so many sects in Islam, Wahhabis, Burelvis, this and that, but we are all together called Muslims. But when you say, I'm a Muslim, the rest of the world does not know, just by your calling yourself a Muslim, whether you belong to Wahhabi faith or Burelvi faith or Shia or Sunni and what not. Right? So to make things easier for introducing your understanding of Islam, you call yourself an Ahmadi. Now why Ahmadi? It also has a deeper significance in the two attributes of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had two names which were meaningful, and they had some attributes, qualities contained in those names. One was Muhammad, right? And the other was Ahmad. The Muhammad name is mentioned in the Old Testament in relation to the advent of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Ahmad name is mentioned in the New Testament by Jesus Christ in relation to Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So his first advent is similar to that of Moses. That is Muhammadi advent. Second advent is similar to Hazrat Jesus Christ. That is why it is said that promised Messiah would come. So the Ahmadi phase is the second phase of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's second advent in the form of another person representing him. Is it too complicated for you, or have you understood? The word Ahmad means Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah. Like word Muhammad means Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah. And Muhammad Rasulullah was the name given to him in relation to the first manifestation of Muhammad Rasulullah. It was glorious and majestic and very quick and very fast. So that Islam spread within his lifetime so rapidly. And the Ahmad was his manifestation, which was slow and which related more to the slow conviction and winning through love, through persuasion, not with a glorious, grand display of majesty. And that is exactly the style of the spread of Jesus Christ's teachings when he came. So because a Messiah was promised to Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and because Jesus himself mentioned his advent as under the name of Ahmad, so from this we understand that God had so designed that in the first instance Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam will manifest his attribute of Muhammadiyyat. And in the latter days, when a Messiah appears in his Ummah, that is the promised Messiah, that is Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam, Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam will display his Shaan-e-Ahmadiyyat or manifestation of Ahmadiyyat. So to remind us that we are in the second phase of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's display of his Shaan-e-Ahmadiyyat. This name was given by Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam. And he has explained it himself in a small booklet in which he has spoken of this. So do not misunderstand the word Ahmad to have originated from Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam's personal name. His name was Ghulam Ahmad. The perfect servant of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And the Ahmad name is originally that of Hazrat Rasulullah. It applies to him only metaphorically. You understand? So in this way, we understand the significance of our title Ahmadiyyat. It is not a new religion whatsoever. It is Islam, and entirely Islam, and nothing but Islam. But Islam as was to appear in the second manifestation of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah's attributes, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Have I made myself clear? Enough for you to understand?
Yeah.
Thank you. You know, to answer children's questions is very difficult, because they ask sometimes very good, very sound questions which need good explanations. But their mental level or level of their knowledge is such as you have to get down to the level and try to explain things to them so that it gets registered, your answer gets registered. That is why I take a bit longer than it might have been necessary otherwise.